Hi everyone, good afternoon. Welcome to Unacademy UPSC Articulate. I am Mehak Rao and this is our series where we are discussing the previous year questions from the section of Environment and Ecology which have been asked in the last 10 years of your UPSC CSE examination. I hope the audio and the video is streaming fine. You all can see me and hear me properly. Just give me a second. I'll check it at my end as well.
See me and hear me properly.
Yeah, hi Suresh, how are you? Good afternoon. Okay. So guys, the one subscription offer is still going on at Unacademy, where if you go for GS as well as the optional combo, you will get 25% flat off. Above that, if you use my code MRAO10, you will get additional 10% off. So this is the old price and this is the new price. So you see there's almost a reduction of almost 30%. This offer is valid only till the 26th. So please make the most use of it. Then for all of you for whom finances are a problem, Unacademy has started this loan initiative where we are giving you loan for your UPSC preparation on the Unacademy platform. So at zero processing fee, 0% interest rate, with no hidden charges and minimal paperwork, you can avail the loan facility. In the description box, we have attached a form. If you go and click on that form and fill in the details, somebody from the sales team will definitely contact you. Good afternoon, Mohit. How are you? Then we also have this mega subscription offer going on where if you are somebody who have already subscribed to Unacademy, then if you want, you can extend your subscription till prelims of next year or next to next year, that is 23. Use my code MRAO10 and you will be able to unlock this offer. Then every Sunday, we have India's biggest free scholarship test going on, available both in Hindi and English. At 11 a.m. known as Unacademy Combat, we have a scholarship pool of 4 crore rupees. It is absolutely free of cost for you to enroll. All you need is my code, that is MRAO10, and you will be able to register yourself for the exam. Here is the benefits or the amount of scholarship which the winners will get. So the first 500 people who rank for top 500 will get some or the other amount of the scholarship. The new batches have started from the 26th of May. We have this Phoenix revision batch for the upcoming prelims examination, because you know prelims has now been postponed. So this is a good opportunity for you to not only revise your prelims again, but to also prepare for your mains. This too starts on the 26th, available in bilingual language, English as well as in the Hindi language. Then we have this Gurukul Plus revision batch, especially focusing on the upcoming prelims examination. UPSC CSE 2021 includes prelim test series, live classes by top educators. This is available in the bilingual language. Okay, this too starts from the 26th. Then we have this 1 year batch course for all of you preparing for the 2022 attempt, available in Hindi, English and in the bilingual language starting from the 26th. We have a 2 year batch course also for those thinking to target the 2023 attempt. This too starts on the 26th. Both your prelims and main syllabus will be covered. It is available completely in English, in bilingual Hindi-English mix, and completely in the Hindi language. Then we have NCERT batch course also going on. On 26th, this new batch starting. Already my batch, where I am dealing and taking with teaching you NCERT quality, will start on the 26th itself. So if you guys want to read or learn NCERT from me, quality NCERT, you could join this batch as well. If you go in for the plus, you will get all these benefits. However, if you choose to go for our iconic subscription, you will get personal guidance, personal mentorship of an exam expert, customized study plan, specialized notes, expert guidelines, test analysis, one-on-one analysis, so on and so forth. This is the subscription cost. My code has changed. It is now MRAO10. If you use this code MRAO10, you get a 10% off. Here are the different durations which are available. You can choose anyone, whichever you want. Already I've told you about the UPSC CSE optional combo, which is going on, where you're getting 25% off and 10% by using my referral code. So yes, let's crack it. So today we are going to look at the 2012 questions which were asked from the environment and the ecology sessions section in the prelims. Good afternoon, Pujalin, if I'm pronouncing your name right. I'm very fine, Suresh. Thank you. Okay, here is the first question. Okay, now this year we had 14 questions from the environment and ecology section. The first question, let's look at it. Consider the following protected area. So this is the list of four protected areas, and it is asking which of the above are declared a tiger reserve. Okay, so of course these are protected, we have to mark which are tiger reserves. Now let's try this with elimination, if that helps. Sundarbans, you know, are known for the Bengal tiger, so definitely Sundarban has to be a protected area. Manas also is a not a protected area. Sundarban is a tiger reserve. Manas too is a tiger reserve. Bandipur is also a tiger reserve. This Bhitarkanika is not. It is what else could have helped you here is by knowing the location or the states in which these protected areas are there. Sundarban, I'm sure everybody knows, is located in West Bengal. Manas is located in Assam. Bandipur is located in Karnataka. Now, if you geographically look at where all the tigers are distributed in the country, we all know that West Bengal, Assam, you do have tigers present. Even in southern India, we have tigers. This Bhitarkanika is in Odisha. The population of tigers relatively is very, very low in Odisha. And this Bhitarkanika is not a tiger reserve, it's a wildlife sanctuary. So, right answer is B, 1, 3 and 4. Other way to look at it, A could not be there because, you know, Sundarban has to be there, and Bandipur is also very, very famous. It's a very famous tiger reserve. So we will see which options has 1 and 4. Okay, B has 1 and 4. Then it depends whether 2 is there or 3 is there. But to solve this question, it was required for you to know whether Bhitarkanika is a tiger reserve or not. Right answer was B, 1, 3 and 4. Okay. Question number 2. Now, this question basically is testing your knowledge about the protected areas and also tests the fact whether you know the difference between the different kinds of protected areas. The question is asking you which one of the following categories of protected areas in India are local people not allowed to collect and use biomass. So basically it is asking with respect to what kind of in which of these certain kind of human activities is allowed or is not allowed. Now, biosphere reserve cannot be there because biosphere reserves as it is are very huge, and it is not possible that people will not be living in that particular area. People, local people, tribal people live in a biosphere reserve, and we have to allow them to carry out human activities. You cannot prohibit human activities. Wetlands declared by Ramsar Convention, this is also incorrect. In fact, this has not, it is not related to collecting and use of biomass. The doubt is between B and D, National Park or Wildlife Sanctuary. Now, one of the major differences between a national park and a wildlife sanctuary is one of them allows human activity, other does not. So, it is the wildlife sanctuary which allows human activity, such as grazing, forestry, collection of forest produce, to a certain extent agriculture also. However, it is your national park in where there is a complete prohibition on any kind of human activity. In a national park, you're not allowed grazing, you're not allowed cultivation, you're not allowed forestry. Only those activities which the chief warden allows, only those you can carry out with his prior permission. Right answer is B, national park. Majority of you, Mohit, Suresh, have given the right answer. Okay, then let's go to the next question. This is with respect to Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. Now, for the longest period, we haven't heard about this topic or concept again, but we are talking about 2012 paper. At that point of time, it was important. Okay? So the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment describes the following major categories of ecosystem services, that is provisioning, supporting, regulating, preserving and culture. Which of the following is a supporting service? Now basically a Millennium Ecosystem Assessment is a kind of assessment which tells you what will be the effect of a human intervention on the ecosystem and its various functions. Now you all must be knowing that ecosystem provides you with certain kind of services, which includes provisioning services, supporting services, regulating services, preserving and cultural services. We have to select which is a supporting service. Now what do we mean by a supporting service? A supporting service is any service which is necessary for production of other services. Okay? Now production of food or water is not a supporting service. It is a provisioning service. Control of climate and disease is also not a supporting service. Maintenance of diversity is like a preserving service and not a supporting service. Out of this, C, nutrient cycle and crop pollination is a supporting service. If there is nutrient cycling, if there is cross pollination, it will support other activities such as agriculture, forestry, cultivation, so on and so forth. So nutrient cycle and crop pollination will help you with production of food and service. So C is the right answer. Okay. Next, let's go ahead to question number 4. So Yash, I'm not very sure as of now, but if you guys want, that can be arranged. As of now, I've not thought. I am thinking to start the Indian Express Explain section from next month because the prelims has been postponed, but let's see. Question number 4, which of the following can be threats to biodiversity of a geographical area? So the question is asking you which of the following can be threats. Okay? So it can be, it cannot be, 50-50. Global warming obviously is right. Fragmentation of habitat is also correct. Third, invasion of alien species is also correct. I hope you guys understand how these three can act as a threat to biodiversity. This is self-explanatory, very, very basic of your environment and ecology concepts. Fourth, promotion of vegetarianism. Now, promotion of vegetarianism, do you think that will be a threat to biodiversity? Well, no. Promoting or not promoting vegetarianism has very less to do as far as acting as a threat to biodiversity. So promoting vegetarianism is not a threat to biodiversity, okay? Just because we are saying that we will eat less animals and more of plants is not a threat. Even vice versa is not a threat, promoting non-vegetarianism. None of them is actually a threat to biodiversity, okay? This is something which is not very much, not specifically related, not directly related. It's too far-fetched. And looking at it also, it should make sense to you that promoting vegetarianism, that's a very personal choice. It would not have such encompassing effect on biodiversity. Had it had such a huge effect on biodiversity, all your protocols, environmental conventions would also be saying that please turn into a vegetarian. Okay, nobody is saying that. So right answer is A, 1, 2 and 3. Okay, good, Mohit Suresh. Okay. But mass scale adoption, exactly, Mohit, will not be happening. Because it's a very, very personal choice. Okay, here only probably in Indian culture, a few culture, you have a religious sentiment attached to eating or not eating non-vegetarian food. But for majority of cultures abroad, that's not the case. Religion and your food habits, eating non-veg is not related. Question number 5. It gives us 3 agricultural practices. And is asking us which of the following will help in carbon sequestration or storage in the soil. So what is carbon sequestration? I'm sure you all know. It is basically when carbon sequestration means that naturally or artificially you are storing carbon in an artificial reservoir or a natural reservoir. So, like your ocean, they act as major source of carbon sequestration. They act as a carbon sink, as you more commonly call it. So, carbon sequestration or storage is nothing but storing of carbon dioxide in natural or man-made kind of reservoirs. It could be caves, it could be oceans, it could be forests, it could be anything. Now let's look at it: contour bunding, relay cropping, and zero tillage. Now these are agriculture practices, and asking which of will help in soil sequestration. Now zero tillage, you have to know what is zero tillage. It's zero tillage or no tillage is that you're not tilling the land. Johar, after every harvesting, you go back and till the soil. Jo khodte ho soil ko, that you do not do. So obviously, if you're not tilling the soil, the amount of carbon dioxide that can be stored will increase. Relay cropping is also a method of agriculture, which promotes agriculture sustainability. Relay cropping is that you are planting multiple crops one after the another, but here what happens is that before you harvest the first crop, before the first crop is harvested, before that only you go and plant the second crop towards the end phase of the first crop. So this helps to better utilize the limited resources. You can save resources such as water, fertilizers, nutrients, so on and so forth. So relay cropping can also help. Contour bending, bunding, I'm sure you all know, in hilly areas you make different kind of contours, and along the slope you are carrying out the agriculture practice, and this basically helps to prevent soil erosion. So if more soil is there and soil is not eroding, that too will help in improving the carbon sequestration. Right answer is C. Okay. Relay cropping and contour bunding also, maybe not directly, but indirectly, they do have an effect on carbon sequestration. See, contour bunding, you know, helps to prevent soil erosion, right? And runoff of the topsoil. So, of course, logically think, if you are preventing the soil from eroding, basically you are able to maintain the top layer of the soil, and that helps you to preserve or store carbon in the soil. So 1 and 3 has to be there. No option says 1 and 3. So definitely it has to be 1, 2 and 3. Question number 6. What would happen if phytoplankton of an ocean is completely destroyed for some reason? The ocean as a carbon sink would be adversely affected. This is correct. The food chains in the ocean would be adversely affected. Definitely, phytoplanktons are the base of the food chain. If phytoplanktons are destroyed, the complete food chain will be disrupted in the ocean. This is also correct. Third, density of the ocean water would drastically decrease. Now, density of ocean water depends on factors such as salinity, temperature, and one more I'm forgetting. But how much of the weight of phytoplankton will have very less to do with the density. Okay, phytoplanktons as it is are microscopic organisms. And the term they have used here is drastically decrease. No, even if the entire phytoplanktons are destroyed, the density of the ocean water will not drastically decrease. This is incorrect. So, you know, C and D cannot be there. And this word also drastically should tell you that phytoplanktons are as it is microscopic. Even if they are completely destroyed, drastically no density will come down. And density, whenever you have read about ocean, it depends on salinity, temperature, availability of fresh water, so on and so forth. So, the right answer to this question is A, 1 and 2 only. Okay, yes, Mohit, right answer, good. Suresh, yes, right answer. Now, this is something I'm sure you all must have read earlier also. Vultures, which used to be very common in Indian countryside, are rarely seen nowadays. This is attributed to destruction of their nesting sites by invasive species, scarcity of food, widespread and persistent and fatal disease among them. Well, the right answer is B. Now, if you knew it, you knew it. If you did not know it, you should not try to take guesses in this question. So there was this drug antibiotic, diclofenac, which was being used indiscriminately by the cattle industry. This diclofenac caused diseases in these vultures. This was fatal to the vultures, and that's why the vultures, because the vultures, they used to eat on the dead bodies of the cattle. So in the dead bodies of the cattle, this diclofenac was stored. So whenever they used to consume these dead bodies, they used to consume the diclofenac, which was fatal to the vultures. Yes, Akash, very sad thing, but okay. Then question number 8. How does National Biodiversity Authority help in protecting the Indian agriculture? Good afternoon, Akash. Now let's look at all the three options. NBA checks the biopiracy and protects the indigenous and traditional genetic resources. Well, this is correct. It is an authority. So authority's main function is to regulate and monitor. So if it's an authority meant for regulation and monitoring of national biodiversity, it will do check biopiracy and protect the indigenous and traditional genetic resources. Second, NBA directly monitors and supervises the scientific research on genetic modification of crops. This is incorrect. Research on genetic modification of crop plants is done by genetic engineering appraisal committee. Okay, it is done by this committee and not by NBA. And plus the word directly also should tell you. It is an authority. Why would it directly supervise scientific research? Scientific research has to be carried out by an organization which is made of researchers or scientific scholars. An authority usually is made of people. The job of authority is more in nature of supervising and what basically your administrators and your bureaucrats do. An authority would not be looking into scientific research directly. So we know 2 is not there. We are left with A and C. Let's look at C. Application for intellectual property rights related to genetic biological resources cannot be made without the approval of the NDA. Now this is correct. Okay. Application for IPR, you require like a NOC certificate or a prior approval of NDA. Of course, that is there. Uske baad, these are other authorities which look into the specific matter. So right answer is C. Theek hai? Question number 9 is with respect to biomass classification. Now till 14-15, we have had a lot of questions based on your environmental concepts. From 16-17, it has changed. The focus now is a lot more on the different kind of agriculture, temperatures, different kind of national parks, so on and so forth. That we'll see as and when we continue. But earlier, if you see, they are asking you a lot of questions based on concepts of environment ecology, whether it is carbon sequestration, whether it is biomass gasification. Then we have a question on ocean acidification. So the questions were more or less based on your books. If you have read your books, basic books properly, you have basics idea, your basics are clear about all these terms, you could have solved the question, unlike the way the questions are now being formed. Biomass gasification is considered to be one of the sustainable solutions to power crisis in India. In this context, which of the following statement is and are correct? Coconut shells, groundnut shells and rice husks can be used in biomass gasification. This is right. Okay, biomass gasification is when you are converting a solid biomass into a gas form of biomass. Then combustible gases which are generated from biomass gasification consist of hydrogen and carbon dioxide only. This word only should tell you it is incorrect. If you have any basic idea about environment or chemistry, you would know one of the byproducts of biomass gasification or when you are generating biomass is methane. In addition to this, carbon monoxide is also released, okay, and of course carbon dioxide and hydrogen is there. So when anything is burning or combusting, carbon monoxide is usually, majority of the time, it is released. So consists only of hydrogen and carbon? No, this is incorrect. So B and D get eliminated. Third, the combustible gases generated from biomass can be used for direct heat generation but not in internal combustion engines. This is correct. Okay, whatever gas, combustible gas which is generated, just to quickly heat it up or use it for a direct heat source, you could use. But to use it in the cars and all, no. That it could not be used directly. You could not directly use it. So, right answer is C. Third statement is correct. D is incorrect because hydrogen and carbon dioxide is not the only byproduct. Methane and carbon monoxide are also released. Good afternoon, Vikas. ठीक है रणधीर द बायोमास विच यू प्रोड्यूस थ्रू बायोमास गैसिफिकेशन यू कैन नॉट यूज डायरेक्टली टू रन योर कार्स ठीक है ऐसे तो डायरेक्टली एनीबडी वुड द कॉम्पोस्ट विच यू हैव इन अ हाउस यू विल कन्वर्ट इन टू बायोमास एंड स्टार्ट यूजिंग इन योर कार्स ऑफ कोर्स दैट इज नॉट पॉसिबल इन कार्स यू यूज कंप्रेस्ड नेचुरल गैस सो डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ एवरी इंजन द वे आर कार्स आर देयर यू कैन नॉट यूज ईच एंड एवरी काइंड ऑफ gas or every kind of even petrol okay you cannot just use crude oil you have to use either petrol or diesel in fact in a petrol car you cannot use diesel so the engines are made in a certain way that they can only run on one fuel so similarly the combustible gas which is generated through biomass gasification whatever gas is produced if you bring a light to near it of course it will start burning so it will help you in a direct heat generation like you can use it for your chulas or some sort of that purpose but you cannot use it to run your cars. Question number 10 is with respect to National Water Mission. Now you could have, this could be included in your geography section also, in your polity, governance, economic and social development sector also but I thought I will put it here in the environment section. If the National Water Mission is properly and completely implemented, how will it impact the country? Basically, it is asking you the objectives of National Water Mission. Number one, part of water needs of urban areas will be met through recycling of waste water. Now, logically think, we have a National Water Mission. Of course, even if you are unaware about this mission, you haven't read about this mission earlier, just use your logic. Whenever we talk about water conservation, we definitely talk about recycling of water, water harvesting, so on and so forth. So yes, recycling of water, waste water will be something this National Water Mission will be talking about. And part of the water needs of urban areas, this seems to be a safe statement. So it is correct. Two, the water requirements of coastal cities with inadequate alternative sources of water will be met by adopting appropriate technologies that allow for the use of ocean water. Okay, let's wait on this. Let's look at the third answer option. All the rivers of Himalayan region will be linked to the rivers of peninsular India. Now, National Water Mission, first of all, this is talking about interlinking of the rivers. Secondly, what should tell you that the statement is incorrect is the fact all rivers. Is it possible that any mission, do you think it is economically or environmentally feasible also to link all the rivers, Himalayan rivers, northern rivers with the peninsular rivers? Of course not. It will not talk about linking all the rivers. Of course, National Water Mission can talk about linking one or two rivers wherever there is scarcity of water, but not all the rivers. So, third is incorrect due to the word all. C and D get eliminated. One you know is correct. Two, let's talk this with fourth also. Then, expenses incurred by farmers for digging bore wells and for installing motors and pump sets to draw groundwater will be completely reimbursed by the government? No. Government can at max give subsidy, can give what? Interest subvention. But just imagine if the government says that for all the farmers to dig bore well, we will, you know, give you full, reimburse full amount of money. What will happen to your groundwater level? And plus government will not have so much of funds only to completely reimburse it for all the farmers in the country. No, maximum government can give some part of it, some portion of it as subsidy or as interest subvention, but not all of it. So third and fourth by logic you can eliminate. This one is right. This was part of the National Water Mission because it's a National Water Mission. It will focus on urban areas. It will also focus on coastal cities. Himalayan states, desert prone area, so on and so forth. So right answer to this question is B, 1 and 2 only. Good. Okay. Randeep, you have to, in a way, change it, process it more, and probably then you can use it. So your natural gas CNG which you are using is also compressed. It is processed in a different way to make it suitable to be run on a particular combustion engine, and then you can use it. But yes, compared to, just generally speaking, compared to petrol and diesel, natural gas is a much more efficient and more environment friendly fuel. That is why all the focus, right? Why in Delhi all your buses and autos have been shifted to CNG? For this reason, because CNG is more efficient and also more environmental friendly. Then this question is about acidification of oceans. Now the acidification of oceans is increasing. Why is this a phenomena, a cause of concern? Now to answer this question, it was important for you to understand what is ocean acidification. Ocean acidification is when the pH level of the ocean water starts to decrease. It starts to become more acidic. Now, the reason for ocean acidification, of course, is global warming. That is, and particularly the increase in the carbon dioxide. Basically, your oceans are the biggest carbon sinks available on Earth. In fact, 1/3 of your carbon is stored in the oceans. But then oceans also have a certain kind of natural capacity till which they can absorb the carbon, freely and efficiently. But since the carbon dioxide which is being released in the environment is increasing at an unprecedented rate, what, of course, oceans do absorb the carbon dioxide, but this carbon dioxide, it gets converted into carbonic acid. And this conversion of carbon dioxide, the reaction with carbon dioxide and water and the creation of carbonic acid is what is causing ocean acidification. And during the process of generation of carbonic acid, what happens is that the number of carbonate ions that decreases in the water, and these carbonate ions is something which helps basically all those plants and animals, as far as whichever plants and animals which are calciraceous in nature. So number one, the growth and survival of calcareous phytoplanktons will be adversely affected. This is correct. Ocean acidification has a direct impact on all the calcareous organisms. Calcareous organisms are all those organisms, including your animals and plants, which have a layer of calcium, a one or the other form of calcium around it. That is why they are known as calcareous. The growth and survival of coral reefs will be adversely affected. This is also correct. Coral reefs are but made of calcareous subcomponents. It also has calcium in it. That is why coral reefs' growth and survival will be affected if the acidification or the amount of carbonic acid in the ocean increases. The survival of some animals that have phytoplanktic larvae would be adversely affected. Let's hold this. Well, this is also correct, because it is saying survival of someone that has phytoplankton larvae will be affected. Correct. The cloud seeding and formation of clouds will be adversely affected. This too is correct. The cloud seeding and the formation of cloud, they also say, does get affected due to the ocean acidification process. Now, UPSC, according to UPSC, the right answer is 1, 2, 3 and 4. So, surprisingly, UPSC does say that, just a second, D is also correct. I did try to find a little bit more on option number 4, but could not really get much. But the official answer key says that 4 is right. So we will stick to it that 4 is right. Sorry. Just a second. Okay. Okay. William, you can go back and check the, what do you call, the answer key if you have any doubt with it. If you have doubt on my answers, you can go and yourself do the effort to open the PDF, official answer key, and cross-check it. No, indeed, this is not Kara, this is black coffee. Question number 12. The increasing amount of carbon dioxide in the air is slowly raising the temperature of the atmosphere because it absorbs. It is asking you, basically, carbon dioxide is absorbing which of the following? Water vapor of the air and retains it heats? No, water vapor and carbon dioxide increase doesn't lead to, carbon dioxide doesn't lead to absorption of water vapor. Carbon dioxide doesn't absorb water vapor. Ultraviolet part of solar radiation, all the solar radiation, or the infrared part of the solar radiation? Well, the right answer is D. Carbon dioxide absorbs the infrared part of the solar radiation, not the ultraviolet part, and also not the all parts of solar radiation. Had it been absorbing the ultraviolet part of the solar radiation, we would not be using sunscreens. Okay? D is the right answer to this. Question number 13. Which one of the following groups of animals belong to the category of endangered species? Now, this is a tough question because this question expected you to know the IUCN status of a lot of animal species. But then, we can use elimination technique. Great Indian bustard, if you would have studied properly, you would know that it is a critically endangered species. It is not endangered, it is critically endangered, Great Indian Bustard. So A cannot be there, and Great Indian Bustard is also present in option number B. So A and B is not there. Then you are left with C or D. Now, snow leopard, swamp deer, rhesus monkey and saurus, you would have read that all these are, in the sense, their existence is threatened and they are left in quite a few numbers, that is there. But let's look at D. Lion-tailed macaque, blue bull, Hanuman langur and cheetal. Now if you look at these two, langur and cheetal, both of them are of least concern. I think langur is vulnerable or of least concern. Cheetal is definitely least concern. Cheetal is basically a kind of a deer which is found in India and its IUCN status is least concern. And obviously otherwise also nahi pata tha. So langur is something that you very commonly also see in your neighborhood. So had langur been critically endangered, I'm sure the government would not allow a man, you know, walking with the langur to shoo away the monkeys. That would not be happening. But it does happen. So this should tell you that langur definitely cannot be critically endangered. So you can eliminate D. Right answer as it is was C. Snow leopard, swamp deer, rhesus monkey and sucks. ठीक है? Yeah, langur shouldn't be there. This is question number 14. Mohit, I will check here. It said it's decrease, it should be decrease only, but I will cross check it again. It says it will be adversely affected. Adversely affected could mean anything, not necessarily that it does mean that it will be reduced, but even if it increases a lot, that also would mean that it is being affected adversely. But I will cross check it for you. Probably there are some other factors also. Just a simple increase in the carbonic content should not so much so reduce or increase the cloud formation. Other factors are also there for cloud formation. It's not just the temperature of your ocean water or the amount of water which is being evaporated. But I will check it. Theek hai? Just let me click on picture of your question. Last, again, this was a question. If you knew it, you should have attempted. If you did not know it, you should not attempt such questions. I don't know why UPSC would give you such a question in the first place. Probably in 2012, these species or these animals were in news, that is why they asked, but उसके बाद ऐसा क्वेश्चन नहीं पूछा where they're asking you different between species. Okay, they do ask you questions based on animals and species, but not differences as such. The right answer to this is A. Oryx is adapted to live in hot and arid areas, where Chiru is adapted to live in steppes and semi-desert areas of cold mountain. Chirus are basically also known as Tibetan deer. Both of them obviously are antelopes. Oryx is, here I've given a picture. This is an oryx, this is a Chiru. So Chiru is basically found in cold deserts and an oryx is found in hot, arid and semi-arid grasslands. Both of them are antelopes, but the difference, major difference is where they are found. Oryx is poached for its antlers, whereas Chiru is poached for its musk. No. This is not the reason. Both of them are, it's not specifically that Chiru is poached for its musk. Both of them are poached for their antlers. Oryx exists in Western India only, whereas Chiru exists in Northeast India only. The only is also incorrect. Broadly, yes, the Chiru exists in the Tibetan region. Tibetan region is close to Northeast India, but only Northeast India would be incorrect. Oryx exists only in the Western India. That too would be incorrect. You do find a few population of them even in the Northern India. Northwestern India, but not particularly only in the Western India. Right answer, even out of all the four, A is the most appropriate and the major difference. B and C are like so-so. So that is why this is a very specific question. If you know it, go for it. Else, do not go for it. Of late, when I have been looking at questions of UPSC from environment section, in a way they have improved in the sense they are not as vague or, you know, as unspecific as they used to be. But the questions to a certain extent are still tough. Questions from environment ecology is tough, but probably UPSC has realized that a lot of students who are appearing for the exam are not necessarily appearing for the Indian Forest Services. So this kind of questions where they ask you very typical questions related to species and all, they have stopped to do it. So they do ask you questions related to species, but general questions, which of them are endangered, where they are found, and all such kind of things, not differences between one specific subspecies of an antelope. So tomorrow we'll discuss 2013 tomorrow. No, I'll meet you on Monday now. And then we will be discussing it. I want to start Indian Express Explained section with you from next month. I want to start this month, but my plus schedule is very, very hectic. So I cannot accommodate as of now. But are you guys interested for the Indian Express Explained section? Would you guys want to see it? Only if you guys want it, will I then go ahead with it. Because the prelims as it is postponed now. We do have 4 months in hand. June, July, August, September, right? 4 months in hand. So I think the focus should go back to your current affairs as of now. So anyways, I will start. Let's see what will be the response. So I hope you guys do know what is the Indian Express Explained section. Okay, it is a very, very important section. Even if you do not read the full newspaper, you should never ever ignore the explained section. And 2019, especially 2019, 2-3 questions were directly picked up from articles which were given in the explained question. There was a question on HCNG, if you remember, that came in the Indian Express explained section. Then there was another question, I can't recall, that too exactly was picked up from the Indian Express explained section. So it is pretty good. I will not just cover with you what comes in the newspaper, I will also cover with you what comes in the digital format. So newspaper, to only 4-5 of them are there, but in the digital format, throughout the day, Indian Express keeps on releasing different aspects of, different topics under the explain. We will pick up the topics which are relevant from UPSC perspective. Okay. Okay, thank you and I'll see you on Monday now at 1:15 again. Is there any other question? Mohit, I will cross-check that question for you, the carbon dioxide one, carbonic acid one. Monday, I will give you an answer for it. approach to read environment is keep your basics as good as possible. Today we saw almost 4 or 5 questions which are asked from your basic terms of environment. But then from past 3 or 4 years, they are not asking you questions based on concepts of environment. The questions are based on national parks. In which climatic zone do the national park lie? Every year there is 2 questions from the national parks. Not national parks, sorry, protected areas. Whether it's a national park, whether it is biodiversity. Questions on species are also there. Whether it's Asiatic lion, whether it's dolphins, whether it is rhinoceros, questions were there. So the focus now, because the trend is changing, this is what we are seeing in the last 3-4 years, you should focus on all this. Protected areas should be on your fingertips. Today also we saw a question on protected areas. So the major national parks of different states, you should probably draw it out on a map. Look, whenever you're studying about a protected area, make sure to see in which kind of climatic zone is that particular area, national protected area following, which state is that protected area in, and any other, which kind of species are found there. This is something you should focus upon. But having said so, it doesn't mean that your basic concepts of environment are not important. 3-4 saal se nahi itne question puche, that doesn't mean it will not ask. So your basics of environment, you have to prepare all these concepts about carbon sink, carbon sequestration, eutrophication, gasification. Also, compared to other subjects, environment is a subject which is more current affairs related, in the sense they tend to ask you questions on technologies or on concepts or on news which were in the newspaper. So like HCNG, it was in news, so they asked you a question. Similarly, this time, last year there was news on hydrogen cell. We were expecting that they would ask you a question on hydrogen cell, though that also forms part of your science section. But they could ask you about that. Hydrogen fuel policy, we have launched a hydrogen fuel policy, biomass, so on and so forth. All of these are certain segments on which it has started to take keen interest. More on this I will tell you when we will reach 2016-17, because when we are dealing with that questions, it will be easier for you to understand from which topics UPSC is asking. But I told you yesterday, I'm telling you again, do not miss out any news related to environment and ecology section in your newspaper, because environment ecology is very, very, if not current affairs related, it is very large and to a certain extent random also. Kuch bhi utha ke pooch lete related to environment ecology, especially the kind of technology. So science and tech, geography and environment ecology to a lot of extent overlap. So that is a few points you should keep in mind when preparing for environment. But having said so, rather than, of course, not that I'm not saying you should not focus on environment, focus on environment, because the 20 questions will be asked, give or take, every year. They have to ask 20 questions from environment ecology, because Indian Forest Service people are also giving the same exam. But there will be around 10 questions which will be easy, 5 will be very, very random, and 5 will be tough. So at least whichever way you prepare, your focus should be at least 10 to 12 you should get correct from this segment. I do not expect students to get 18 out of 20 right, until and unless you come from that kind of science background or have knowledge about environment. But here is why your polity, history, geography and all of this becomes important. These are subjects, polity, history, economy, where if 20 questions are asked, if you prepare it very well, 18 questions you will get right. Acts, yes, Mohit, acts you have to focus upon, but acts also in a way are related to your polity section. So NGT has been in news last year, this year. There could be a question on NGT. Wildlife Protection Act and all, they haven't asked for a very long time, but they won't usually ask on wildlife protection. These are old acts. They will ask you questions on rules, solid waste management rules, e-waste management rules, hazardous waste management rule. Okay, so all of this you could focus on. Biomedical rules, hazardous waste rule, so on and so forth. But these again could be part of your polity, could be a part of your environment. Coastal zone regulations, that is something you should know very well. Environmental impact assessment is again very, very important. Last year, the rules were changed as far as environmental impact assessment is concerned. So those two become important. Lakshita? So sorry, in YouTube, you do not have the option of pausing. Okay, so that is all you should focus upon. Once we are done with the series, I will give you a list of topics which you should definitely cover as a bare minimum as far as environment is concerned. So environment quality have started to overlap. So prepare it in that way. Okay, Mohit? Anything else? There's a lot of lag. Sorry. There's almost 30 seconds left. Okay, thank you so much, and I'll take your leave now. I have a class at 5. Any other doubt you have, please write in the comment box below. And the questions, I understand, seem to be a little tough, a little random, and not really making sense. But after 15, 16, they will still be tough, but they will make more sense to you, at least from the environment section, if you talk about that. So, but we have to cover from 2011 to 2020. So we will go on in that manner itself. Thank you so much. I'll see you guys on Monday at 1:15 p.m. Thank you. Have a great weekend. Enjoy, stay safe. Keep your family safe. Do not go out. Maintain social distancing. Take Sunday off. Watch Netflix. Chill and sleep.